Economists define capitalism abstractly, but it is also important to understand that capital changes through time. The dominant form of capital today is finance capital. This doesn't mean that older forms of capital disappear, but they become increasingly financialized. To understand financial capital, we must define what credit money is, and therefore the origin of money itself. It is surprising how confused people are still about the nature of money. My argument is that money is first a social and political force before it is a medium of exchange or payment. Realizing the true nature of credit money also explains why finance capital is inherently unstable, and that the financial crisis of 2008, for example, is the norm and not the exception. Money is the most mysterious of commodities. It can be bought and sold, but we also use it as a means of payment to buy goods and services. To simplify, we can say that there are two basic ways of thinking about money. Money as a medium of exchange and money as money of account. The latter is the measure of value. Think of your bank account. The orthodox way of thinking about money is that it is first a medium of exchange and money of account follows from that. The heterodox way of thinking about money is that it is first money of account and exchange follows from that. What the orthodox theory of the origin of money conceals, which is the one you will find in economic textbooks, is the social and political origin of money. In so doing, it hides the real origin of money. Let us look at the orthodox theory of money first, because that's the usual way that people think about money, and then go on to examine the heterodox one. How then does the orthodox economist explain the origin of money? They start with the seemingly obvious historical fact of barter in so-called primitive societies. I have candles, you have chickens. I want chickens, you want candles. So we exchange candles with chickens. So let us say we decide to exchange 5 candles for 1 chicken. Everyone is happy. This is okay for one simple transaction, but it isn't going to work for multiple different transactions between different people and for different goods and services. This is why money is invented. It allows us to express the value of goods and services abstractly. So we say a candle is worth 50p and a chicken £2.50, and so on. So in this account, money of account, pounds and pence, comes from money as exchange. Take another example that is a favorite in economic textbooks. Cigarettes in a prison. They only become money of account, 10 cigarettes pays for 1 SIM card, because originally they were a measure of barter. The problem with this example, as with the previous one, is it doesn't really explain how we jump from the concrete to the abstract. How did 10 cigarettes become worth 1 SIM card? How did cigarettes become a money of account? There just seems to be a mysterious leap of faith. If a tin of peaches were worth 5 cigarettes for one person and 3 for another, and then different numbers of cigarettes on different days, how did cigarettes suddenly become an abstract money of account one day? There seems to be something missing in our explanation. The heterodox theory of money has a completely different explanation. It is that money of account makes exchange possible and not exchange money of account. First, it argues that the image of money arising out of barter is a myth. There is no anthropological evidence of it whatsoever. In fact, the opposite is the case. Money of account, as the measurement of credit-debt relations, existed long before the use of money as a medium of exchange. The first examples of money are not people buying chickens, but the record of debt on stone tablets in Mesopotamia. We do not, at least in human history, first have barter, then exchange, then money of account. But the last in the series is first, money of account. This also explains the cigarette example. They can only function as a medium of exchange because they stand in for money of account that pre-exists them. There is perhaps a good reason for the popularity of the economic myth, because what it conceals is the true origin of money, which is political power. The reason that money of account can measure value, sterling for example, is the power of the state. And the reason why everything is counted in this form of money is because that is the money of account that the state demands in the payment of taxes. Ultimately, all money goes back to debt, and primarily the debt that we all owe the state through taxes. And what supports this whole system is power or force. The state, of course, has a monopoly over force. Only the state can create money. Anyone else who attempts to create money will be, of course, arrested immediately. Think of all the laws against counterfeit. If other institutions can create money, so for example, as we'll see in capitalism, banks, that's because the state allows them to do so. All money ultimately goes back to money of account. That's the reason why coins have value. They measure the money of account, which is purely abstract. It doesn't matter whether these coins have gold or silver in them, that doesn't change their value. They are an abstract measurement of value. A pound coin is worth a pound, money of account, whether it has gold in it, no gold in it, or certain amounts of gold. And this has always been the case in the whole history of coinage. Coins don't come first. Money of account does. And coins, like any other form of money, including cigarettes, are just an abstract measure of money of account. And again, ultimately, money of account has its origin in political power and in debt relationships, relations of credit and debt. Money of account in capitalism is credit money. And it is more important to the development of capitalism than any other factor. We might understand capitalism as the explosion of credit money. As a technology, credit money has its origin in bills of exchange, which increasingly came to replace coinage. But like with everything else, we can only understand this socially and historically. That is, with a specific example of the explosion of credit in 16th and 17th century in England, which really explains why England became the major industrial power in the 18th and 19th century. First of all, in the reign of Elizabeth I, the English state gained control of coinage. Bills of exchange were a private relation between bankers and traders, which could be used to pay off debt to a third party. They were not, however, supported by the state because sovereignty was seen in coinage. Think of the head of the Queen that is still stamped on our coins. Remember that coins still represent money of account, so anything can be money. You just need the right historical circumstances to make it possible, which is precisely what happened in England in the Glorious Revolution of 1688. William came king by the authority of Parliament. This meant that it was Parliament that had the real authority. And Parliament was, of course, the Parliament of traders and bankers. It follows, then, that the state now, through its power, authorized bills of exchange as means of payment, just as previously the state had authorized money of account as coins. The fact that the state could now create credit money through the Bank of England meant there was a large increase of money available to merchants and traders to expand production in the way that it was not so in France, for example, where taxation was still used as wealth extraction rather than to support the creation of credit. Capitalism, because it essentially exists in credit money, which is always a speculation on the future, is inherently unstable. This instability, of which the financial crisis of 2008 is the most recent example, will be the topic of the next lecture.